Hello people, this is Sonali, the melodramatic bookworm. Welcome back to my channel. I'm here today with my reading wrap-up for the month of July 2020. So what I've decided to do is film this wrap-up in two parts. I mean, going forward, I will film my wrap-ups for each month in two parts. One on at the middle of the month, around 15-16, when I've completed a certain number of books. I'll film the first half of my wrap-up in the middle of the month, and then at the end of the month, after the month is done, then I'm going to film another part talking about the books that I've read in the second half of the month. So that's easier for me because my memory, as you know, is trash. So today is the 15th of July, and as of today I have read 5 books. I have finished reading 5 books, and I'm reading 2 other books: Birthday by Meredith Russo, The Angel's Beauty Spots by K.R. Meera, Orphaned, written in Kannada by S.L. Bhairappa and translated into English by Sandeep Balakrishna, Heidi by Johanna Spyri, Kafka on the Shore by Haruki Murakami. So that was the first part of my wrap up for July. But before we get on with this video, you know, self-plug, it's coming. I make book-related videos on this channel, and occasionally a few travel-related and a few movie-related videos as well. So if you like my content and if you like what you see, then don't forget to hit subscribe and click on the bell icon so that you can stay updated as when I post new videos. So it's a few days after the end of July, and I'm here to talk to you about the second half of my July reading. And the first half, from July 1st to July 15th, I read about 5 books. But then after that, from 15th to the end of the month, I read 12 and a half books. So in all, it was a great reading month. I read 17 and a half books. And I'm here to talk about the second part of it. So we've already seen these 3 books, which I've talked about in the first section. And then I read 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 physical copies and a few other ebooks and audiobooks as well. So let's just get straight into it. So the 6th book that I read in July was an audiobook called All Boys Aren't Blue by George M. Johnson. I listened to this on Libro FM as part of the ALC program, and I enjoyed it a lot. I mean, it's not enjoying. I could say I enjoyed the narration. This is a memoir manifesto kind of book in which the author talks about growing up as a black gay teen and his experiences, and how the people around him supported him, how his experiences shaped him into the person he is today, and his pillars of support, people he loved, people that loved him, people that didn't like him, and how all of this played a part in his life. It's really wonderful to read. It's not a long book, it's just a few hours long, but it creates such an impact in those few hours that I was left reeling at one point. And all this the author does by narrating snippets from his own life. The author also narrates how he came to terms with his own sexuality, and combined with his experience as a black person, and he talks about how it all shaped him into the person he is and into the person he has become. And the way the author has narrated it, it was raw, it was honest, as memoirs that are narrated by the authors are wont to be, because they know everything that they've put into the book and they know how to bring it out with the correct nuances. So this was also a book like that. I gave All Boys Aren't Blue 4 out of 5 stars. The 7th book that I read in July was Clap When You Land by Elizabeth Acevedo. I was so excited to read this book, and the moment the Kindle version dropped to an affordable price, like, it was very affordable, and I bought it. And I also listened to the audiobook while reading the book, and it was amazing. I loved it. Like, I didn't love it as much as I loved The Poet X and With the Fire on High, but this was a beautiful story as well. This is a story of Camino Rios and Yahaira Rios, two girls, two stepsisters in two different countries, who learn of each other's existence after their father dies in a plane crash, and how these two families, these two girls, accept each other into their lives, if they do, that is, how these families converge in this grief, and how they take these circumstances that have suddenly befallen them, and how grief can make you into a completely different person than who you are. That forms the entire story, and I cannot explain how emotional, how atmospheric this whole book is. Elizabeth Acevedo knows how to write. This book is in verse, and she has written it so beautifully. Everything, every single detail, everything that goes through the girls' minds. Like, why did father not do this? As long as he was alive, he had this other family in the other in another country as well. How many more lies has he told us? So she makes the characters confront their own thoughts and their own doubts. She makes them understand familial responsibility and everything that comes with familial responsibility, loyalty and love and grief, and how circumstances have the power to change all of them. And as I mentioned before, I absolutely love this. If you are going to read this book, then please do so on audio, because Elizabeth Acevedo's narration is simply amazing. She's something else. And if you can, then please do read the book while listening to the audiobook. It's a whole different experience altogether. I gave Clap When You Land 4.5 out of 5 stars. The next book that I read in July was November 9 by Colleen Hoover. As you know, I'm a huge fan of Colleen Hoover's writing, and I thought this was also going to be one that would make me cry, and I was really looking forward to it. And although it did live up to certain expectations, I did not cry, which is a surprise. This is a story of Fallon and Ben, who meet as a coincidence somehow on November 9, and the next day is when Fallon is moving across the country because she wants to change her circumstances. But they spend the whole day together and they are like, should we keep this up across the country? But Fallon is more like, long distance relationships, no. So they make a pact saying that they will meet on November 9 every year without having any contact throughout the rest of the year. Like, what happens when the significance of the date becomes obvious, and there are so many reasons behind why the characters behave the way they do, especially on this date. But what happens when one day Fallon suddenly thinks, or she finds out something that will make her question Ben's love for her, Ben's loyalty to her? Will they be able to sustain their relationship through it all? Will Ben be able to prove to her that he is loyal to her and he was always loyal to her? Or is it true or is it untrue? Is Ben loyal, or is our Fallon's doubts true? I really like how Colleen Hoover has written the story. They don't have contact during the entire year. They come into contact only on November 9 at a pre-decided place. And I love how she brought it out. I mean, I can understand that it's sort of insta love and all. You meet one day and then for 365 days you maintain that attraction to that person. That sounds a little improbable. But I don't know, while reading this book, I'm like, you need to go meet that person. Why are you doing this? Don't you see? They're your soulmate. And I was rooting for them the whole time. I don't know what else to say about this book, because this is one such book which, you know, you look forward to read so much, and then it flows and flows, and you're caught up in the flow and you're not thinking about anything else. That's exactly what happened. And I think that's the case with any of Colleen Hoover's books. Like, you're so immersed in the plot that once you emerge from it, you're like, okay, I loved it, but I don't know what else to say about it except to gush about it. So that's exactly what happened with this. It's not my favorite Colleen Hoover book. All Your Perfects is still my favorite. But still, this is really good, except for the fact that it's insta love, and I'm not a huge fan of insta love. This somehow made me want to believe in that notion of, you know, being able to fall in love at first sight and knowing that the other person is their immediate soulmates and all that. I gave November 9 4.25 out of 5 stars. The next book that I read in July was a NetGalley ARC that I received, and it's called Fangs by Sarah Anderson. Sarah Anderson is one of my favorite comic makers online. Is that what they're called? Comic makers? Anyway, she makes some amazing comics. Like, Adulthood is a Myth is one of my favorite comics, and I love it. If you follow her on Instagram, you'll see that she has a lot of, you know, relevant comics on her page, and I always love what she does. And this is also one such book. It's the love story between a werewolf and a vampire, and it's, oh my god, it's so darn cute. Everybody should read this when it comes out. Go and read it, because I don't know, if I say one thing, I'm going to be spoiling it for the rest of you. So I really don't want to do that, but I loved it. I gave it a full 5 out of 5 stars. And if possible, I'll just leave a panel somewhere if you want to check it out. And But you know, if I do that, I'll probably be, you know, ruining the thing, because there's a flow. There's some sort of a flow that happens from the first panel to the last panel, and you will enjoy it so much. Trust me on this. The next book that I read in July was Norse Mythology by Neil Gaiman. I read this book while listening to the audiobook narrated by Neil Gaiman himself, and he has a way with narration. He narrates amazingly well, and I really enjoyed the experience of, you know, reading this book, of imbibing everything that he was trying to say. And this is about the Norse mythology, Odin, Thor, Loki, Lady Sif, and everybody else. And unlike what Marvel has done with this, this is so much different. There are so many different Norse myths that are so weird to read. I mean, I think all myths are like that, be it Greek myths, Norse myths, Hindu myths, everything sounds a little weird for this time and age, but they are there and they are so much fun to read. Like, you can say, see that happening. So you see how Odin lost his eye, about how Thor and Loki were with each other, who Loki was, the god of mischief obviously, and what happened when Loki, you know, did a lot of mischief. And then there's Heimdall as well. And so there are a lot of characters that you sort of feel a kinship to while you're reading, and especially when Loki does his pranks and people are like, Loki, and you're like, Loki, don't, they are gods, like, you know what they're going to do to you. And I'm like, Loki wouldn't do that, but he will, and he won't have a single bolt of remorse. So my suggestion is, if you're going to read this book, listen to the audiobook as well. It's going to be an amazing experience, and Neil Gaiman will take you through this journey himself, and it's going to be wonderful. I gave Norse Mythology 4.25 out of 5 stars. So the next book that I read was my first read for the reading rush, and that book is The Silent Patient by Alex Michaelides. I'd heard a lot of good things about this book, that it was a great psychological thriller, it's gripping, and it will, you know, put you on your toes throughout the book. And though I agree that the story is gripping, it's fast paced, and I did not want to put this book down, I must disagree when they say that this is such an amazing book. No, it's just my opinion, but this, I felt like it had been done before, and it reminded me a lot of Agatha Christie's The Murder of Roger Ackroyd. So this book is about Alicia Berenson, who is an artist who is critically acclaimed and all that, and she has been married to Gabriel for a while now. But one day something happens and she shoots Gabriel in the face 5 times. But after this, she does not speak a single word. Like, there's nothing that can make her speak. She has just shut it in the court case as well. She has not spoken a word. And then she is sent to an asylum. Enter Theo Faber. He is a psychologist, and he thinks that he will be able to make Alicia speak. He wants to try and make her speak and learn what is troubling her, but there is something that is going on, that is brewing. And does it mean that Alicia will speak to Theo, or is Theo the only person who can make Alicia speak? What is it that's going on? What is the connection that begins to be forged between the two of them that forms the entire story? And you know, I did enjoy reading this book. Like, it was fast-paced and gripping, as I mentioned before, but the thing is, at one point I was like, I did not see this coming, but I also somehow subconsciously, I knew that something like this was going to happen. So that part of the surprise was ruined for me, because it was something that I had seen before. It was something very similar to what I had seen before, like in The Murder of Roger Ackroyd. If you've read it, you'll know what I'm talking about. So even though it was well written, it was fast paced, but there was that one single thing that upset the whole situation. Like, when that plot twist happens, I'm like, oh, that was ingenious. But somehow I couldn't keep that surprise. I couldn't keep that awe of the story, of the plot. And maybe that's the problem with the book. I can't really tell. But you know, I am probably one of the very few people who are like, about this book. I gave The Silent Patient 3 out of 5 stars. The next book that I read in July was my second read for The Reading Rush, and that book is The House in the Cerulean Sea by T.J. Klune. T.J. Klune is now one of my favorite authors. That's all I'll say. I'm reading The Extraordinaries right now, and I am loving it. I'm loving it to no end. But The House in the Cerulean Sea, it's so amazing. So this is a story of Linus Baker, who is a caseworker for the department, the whole government or something. I don't even remember. Garbage memory. Anywho, he gets assigned to this orphanage to see, to look over how they are treating the children. All these orphanages to which he gets assigned, these children are special children. Like, they have magical abilities and they are different from other children who are usually brought up in orphanages. But he gets assigned to this house, and once he reaches there, it's an island, okay, it's in the middle of the Cerulean Sea, okay, and he gets introduced to 6 children and the people around them, and their caretaker, their father figure, is Arthur Parnassus, and he goes to live there for the month according to the instructions of the management, and extremely important, or extremely upper management, I think that is called. So he goes to live there for a month, and then he has a load of revelations, and I can't actually talk much about it because then I'll be giving away a lot, because this book is about accepting yourself, about accepting the next person for what they are, about seeing the good beneath their exterior, and not judging people and not judging anyone who you meet for the first time based on your first encounter itself. There's a lot of things going on in there, and it shows how you can become a better person without realizing it yourself sometimes, and about how you can work hard to become a better person, to become a better version of yourself. And there's so much good in there, wholesome goodness. So I'm just going to say, go read it. Go read The House in the Cerulean Sea and come back, and then we can gush about it together. Go read it, please, right now. I don't care what you're doing. I mean, put it aside and go and read this book. Please, I beg you. I gave The House in the Cerulean Sea full 5 out of 5 stars. What did you expect? The next book that I read in July was my third read for The Reading Rush, and that book is Seeing Like a Feminist by Nivedita Menon. The author has written a spectacular book about how to, you know, see the world as a feminist, but it's not as simple as that. It's about also intersectional feminism. It's about seeing the world while being aware of laws, of religion, of sexuality, and about so much more that will come in your way. You know, reading this reminded me of one other amazing book that I read this year. It's called Fight Like a Girl by Clementine Ford. But the point is, Fight Like a Girl is raw. It has all that anger of, you know, millennia past of women who have been oppressed by men. And while the narration of those facts are blunt as well, this book is rather more quiet. It makes its point. It talks about how this and this thing affects feminism, about how law is in India, about how law is around the world. I mean, it does not talk a lot about around the world. It talks about India in specific, but otherwise it gives a very clear picture of how things are and how things were and how things might be and how they will turn out to be. And it's more of a matter of fact kind of narration here, and I love it because there's a lot of things that I learned from this book as well, and I know for sure that I will be rereading this book. Especially, there's one quote especially that I really love, which I also mentioned in my Reading Rush reading vlog. It's about how men would react if they were to menstruate. They would make it into this holy macho thing, like without which you cannot undertake the burdens, the pressures of this world and all that. And I love how the author has reference to those quotes, because that was a quote by Gloria Steinem, and she has done a lot of referencing, but I really love that she has put this into one particular book. So yeah, this is a book on feminism that I would really, really, really suggest. And irrespective of your gender, this is a book that you really must read. It's about sexuality and religion and law, and how the intersection of all three, you know, makes feminism into what it is, what it could be, and how it should be seen. So I think this is a book that everybody must read. I'm saying it again, and I will say it again. And this book is one that everybody must read. Yeah, I've said it again. I gave Seeing Like a Feminist 4 out of 5 stars. The next book that I read in July was Ready Player One by Ernest Cline. This is a story set in the future. It's set in 2044, in which there's a thing called Oasis where people can spend their time, especially because the world has become an ugly place. The Oasis is a virtual utopia created by James Halliday. James Halliday is a multi-billionaire, I think, and he is the creator of the Oasis. And what he does is, when he passes away, he creates a game, and there are 3 levels to it. And if anybody were to solve this puzzle, to solve all of this, then they would inherit all his property. Everything, every penny that he owned. And there are obviously people like corporates who come in and try to get their hands dirty in all this, and because they want to inherit that whole thing because they have plans. But there's this one kid called Wade Watts who is a huge fan, and he has done all his research. He has looked into a lot of things. He has done his research. He has learned about James Halliday's favorite movies and all the pop culture things. And he is about to descend into this war zone, literally war zone. So what happens throughout the book forms the entire story. And will Wade Watts be able to find the keys and be able to solve this puzzle forms the entire story. I watched the movie before I read this. That was a prompt. Read a book of which... the movie of which you've already watched, and I really love the movie. And this is the case, is one off case where the movie is better than the book, in my opinion, because the book, there are so many 80s pop culture references. Like, I mean, it's not a bad thing to put it in there, but every single paragraph has one 80s reference. There are so many obscure references as well. I didn't know what to make of it. It's a little annoying because you have to keep going and searching what exactly is this? What is this person talking about? Though half the time you get it from the context, and then you are like, at one point I went, I'm not going to look it up anymore. Let it be. Even if it's there, I'm not going to look it up. I'm just going to go with the flow of the story. And I did just that for at least half of the book. But it is fast paced, and I really love how the author has, you know, put everything, all the pop culture references around a skeleton. I found it annoying at times, but at other times I also found that it was a, you know, good thing that the author was able to take so many references and spread them in a way that made sense, that interacted, that interconnected with each other. So that was the plus point of the whole book. And though I'm not a big fan of the book when compared to the movie, I really enjoyed the movie, and they were sure to keep all the references that were widely popular. So if you're into 80s pop culture references, and if you like that sort of thing, and if you want to, you know, get into that sort of thing, then I think this will be a book that you will really enjoy. I gave Ready Player One 3.5 out of 5 stars. The next book that I read in July was The Little Bookshop in Herring Cove by Kelly Hales. Yeah, this was not a book that I enjoyed. This is about, I don't even remember the characters' names. This is about Sophie, who has a bookshop called All Booked Up in Herring Cove. And there's this huge company who's trying to get her to sell, to, you know, put up a resort. They want to build a resort in that town and make it into that rustic, they want to give tourists a rustic, nice seaside experience. But she is not willing to give up because she has a lot of memories associated with that place. And Alexander Fletcher, however handsome, however tall, however muscular, however with a disarming smile he might be, and however kind he might be, because he helps her a lot by building her bookshelves and all. He is kind and all, but he is not going to, you know, get her to sell it. She's never going to sell. But what happens when she finds herself falling for the same guy, and what happens when eventually it all catches up, forms the entire story. See, the thing is, it feels like I've read this before, because there was not much of a conflict here. And even the conflicts that were created towards the end, it was sort of like, really, those were flimsy. that's all I'll say. Those were really flimsy and I really got annoyed with the way it was written. But all I'll say is that it's a fast read and you will quickly understand whether you are going to like the book or not, like I did. And I was really neutral about it. I did not like a few things, like I mentioned before, because who does that? Like, you got pissed off at him without allowing him to speak and you did not talk to your dad about it. Okay, I'm still in that zone about this book, but yeah, so that happens within this book. So if you are preparing to, you know, read it, then I'll just suggest read it. It's okay. Like, I gave it a 3 stars and it was an okay for me, but maybe in a couple of months or something I might even drop the rating. As of now, it's fine. Oh, I still haven't removed this. Oh, nice. The next book that I read in July was a buddy read with Nandini at Read Dream Repeat on Instagram, and that book is The Guernsey Literary and Potato Peel Pie Society by Marianne Schaffer and Annie Barrows. The thing is, my thoughts about this book haven't changed. I really, really enjoyed reading this book even the second time around. I laughed, I cried, my heart broke, my heart was warmed. There's a lot of things going on, and while I read this, I was like, it feels like I'm coming home. So that's exactly what it was. I did a full review for this book on my channel. If you'd like to check that out, then I'll leave the link here as well as the description box below. But please keep in mind that I did this review a long time ago. This was in 2018 when I was new to BookTube. So please don't judge me for being too exuberant when I said, "Hi guys." So I completely forgot. Even the second time around, I gave The Guernsey Literary and Potato Peel Pie Society a full 5 out of 5 stars because it has my whole heart. The last book that I finished reading in July was Slices of Life by Richa Gupta. Thank you to the author for giving me a review copy of this book. This is a collection of short stories of various genres. It has futuristic fiction, it has domestic fiction, contemporary, and those that talk about women empowerment, familial relationships, friends, and romances and daily life. And there's so much more in this book. I enjoyed reading it. I love the variety of themes and genres that the author has packed in this collection of short stories. It's a really difficult thing to do, and the author has done that. And every story has that, you know, underlying sense of women empowerment, which I really enjoy. Breaking away from toxic relationships, learning about the shades in every relationship, about parent-child relationships and how they can change over time, and how important a role they can play in your life. The author, you know, looks at all of these, but there are also a few problems that I had with the book. Is that the author has used unnecessarily complicated big words. It becomes repetitive after a while, and then there is a point where the dialogues and the narrative becomes disconnected with each other. But I feel like the pros outweigh the cons, and that this is a book that you can pick up if you are looking for a variety of genres within short stories. I did a full written review of this book on my blog. If you'd like to check that out, I'll leave the link in the description box below. I gave Slices of Life 3 out of 5 stars. The half book that I read was American Gods by Neil Gaiman. I'm about 160 pages and I'm still considering it half. And I find that it is easy to read, but it's a lot of, I don't know, I'm not is really on board with the idea so far. Like, Neil Gaiman hasn't convinced me that this is a good idea for a book, but I feel like if I give it a little more time, I will be able to get into it. There's also one more book that I'd like to talk to you about, which I should have included in my June wrap-up, but I could not. But it's called When I Find You by Shalini P. Savkar, and this is a short story. It's a thriller kind of story. This is a story of Nikhil Arora, who travels to Bangalore to, you know, in the guise of attending a conference, but he actually is there to settle some scores. But someone in his office, Vidya, an employee, has caught on, and she becomes a inconvenience to him. What is this inconvenience? Why is she an inconvenience to him? And why does Nikhil have to, you know, settle scores? What are the scores? Who is he settling the scores with? This forms the entire story. And although I did find it to be a fast-paced, gripping read, like, you want to know what happened, you want something amazing to come next, you want it to hit you across the face, but I thought that a lot more flesh could have been added to the story, a lot more nuance could have been added, the story could have been edited in a much better manner, and it could have been packaged better. There are also some problems with how people are represented in here. None of the characters are smart or intelligent or even remotely likable. You cannot describe a heavy person as burly swine or something, things like that. If these had been corrected, then things would have been a lot better for the story. Okay, so those were the books that I read in July 2020. Which ones have you read? Which ones did you want to read? Which ones have you read in July? Which of these do you want to read? Which ones of these have you read? Which reviews do you agree with? Which ones do you disagree with? Which of these is your favorite? Let me know in the comments below. I'd love to hear from you. If you like this video, please like it and share it to spread the word. And if you like my content and would like to see more from me, don't forget to hit subscribe and click on the bell icon beside the subscribe button to get notified as and when I post new videos. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. Until next time, keep reading, keep watching, and add melodrama to your life.